together and sing. You guys ready to worship this morning? Yeah. Just sing with me. This is the word.
This is the word. Here in the flesh, living among the weak and lonely, the voice of God, His every breath, salvation of the world unfolding. Behold Him, behold Him, lift up your eyes, see the Son.
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Brittany Dodwell and I serve as a part of our worship ministry here. I'm so glad that you're here, and hey, it's been such an encouragement to me to hear that people from all over the world are tuning in to worship with us. And so wherever you're watching from, whether you're at home, whether you're at work, whether you're in your car, or in a different time zone, let us know where you're coming from in the comments below. So if it's your first time, I want to give you an especially warm welcome. I'm so glad that you're here. No matter how you found us or how you've tuned in, we're glad that you're here. And so if this is your first time, or if it's your 15th time, or you've lost count, this is the part where we want you to check in. And so you can do that right here on the Harvest Bible Chapel website or through the link in the comments below, and also on your Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know that you're here, but more importantly, this is a way that we get to pray for you, specifically for you. So whatever it is, whatever's going on, make your request known to the Lord and allow us to partner with you in prayer this week. If you're not a guest, we also want to encourage you at this point to worship through your giving. This is just a reminder that we have four ways that you can give. You can give online on this page, or you can also hold your phone up to the QR code on the screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page on the Harvest Bible Chapel website. You can also give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, through text or by mail, and send your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. Hey, we are so thankful for the good work that the Lord is allowing us to do through the Hope Center. We're able to provide food for people in our community who are in need, and even those in our church. So here's a look at the Hope Center in Elgin. Take a look.
Hey everyone, I'm really super excited to introduce you to our new Hope Center here at the Elgin campus. This has been an amazing work of the Lord and how He's provided for not only the food, but the donations and the volunteers to make this happen. We've seen anywhere from between 30 and 100 families come every week since we had our opening, and it's just been really fun for us to see how the Lord has been working not only in the lives of our volunteers, but the people we're ministering to.
And you know what, church? It wouldn't be happening without you. Starting with the Closer campaign, remember that? Thanks to your investment in that work God was doing here at our church, we've been able to build out the space to make the Hope Center a reality. And then those contributions every week with the brown bags, you guys are helping to equip the Hope Center with the practical needs that are helping us to meet the needs of the people in our community. Plus, we're partnering with the Northern Illinois Food Bank and local stores that are helping us to have fresh produce and meats and all kinds of other good things for the people. Because you know what we're really getting after here with the Hope Center is meeting people's practical needs, helping them in that very practical way in order to then have the opportunity to share with them the hope of Jesus Christ. So Rebecca, people now are probably wondering, how can I be involved with the Hope Center? So tell them about that.
Number one, let's pray. We'll pray that the Lord continues to provide for us here, and pray for the opportunity to share the love of Christ and share the gospel with the people we're ministering to. Then we've had several volunteer opportunities all throughout the week, whether it's picking up food, sorting food, bringing food in, even on Sunday mornings. You come on Saturday morning, you can help with these guys, really minister and talk to and pray with and shop for and pack groceries. It's really a fun time.
Awesome. Hope Center, let's go.
Again, we are so excited about what the Lord is doing through the Hope Center, allowing us not just to feed people's bodies, but also to feed their souls. And so if you or someone you know could use some help from the Hope Center, they are open every Saturday from 10 a.m. to noon at our Rolling Meadows, Elgin, and Crystal Lake campuses. So Pastor Tommy will be with us today. Pastor Tommy Creutz is going to be wrapping up the series on the Holy Spirit called Ministry. Today we are taking a look at the ministry of the Holy Spirit through me. And so we're excited to jump into God's Word together. We have a new series starting next Sunday with Dr. Ry Delnick. He'll be teaching through the book of Ephesians. He's calling it Living in Light of Our Eternal Portfolio. So take some time this week to read through Ephesians 1 in preparation for next Sunday. Hey, this week we have another worship night in the Rolling Meadows campus. It's this Thursday, March 11th at 7:30 at the Rolling Meadows campus. Take a look at this video. I don't know about you, but I'm excited. I plan to be there and I hope that you can join us. But if you can't be with us in the room, you can't join us in person, you can also watch online at harvestbiblechapel.org. You guys, we are less than a month away from Easter. I can't believe it. But in addition to our Easter services being live on every campus and online, there are three special events we want to tell you about first. Good Friday, our services will be in person on all six of our campuses and online Friday, April 2nd. This in-person service does require a ticket, but tickets are free. Registration is now open for Good Friday at harvestnow.info. Next, we're hosting a Seder dinner on Sunday evening, March 28th. That's Palm Sunday. So the Passover Seder is a dinner that blended Jewish traditions, food, song, and storytelling. And so spaces for this event are limited, and it will be hosted at our Rolling Meadows campus and led by Dr. Michael Rydelnik. For more information and to get your tickets, go to harvestnow.info. And finally, just for our children, we are hosting an Easter birthday party at the Rolling Meadows, Elgin, Crystal Lake, Aurora, and North Shore campuses on Saturday, March 27th. So much I could say here, but I would like to direct you once again to harvestnow.info for more information. Whew, okay, that was a lot to remember, but I do hope that you will be a part of these events as we remember the sacrifice of Jesus and celebrate the resurrection together. So as we continue in our service, will you join me in prayer? God, you are so good. May you grant us the vision to never lose sight of that. God, thank you for the good work that you are doing in and through this church, God. Thank you for all of the lives that are being saved and changed and reached through this ministry, God. We love you, Lord, and we're so grateful for this opportunity to be able to gather together and lift high your name and worship you and exalt you to the rightful place that you deserve, God. So as Pastor Tommy brings your word, God, I pray that you would, that he would decrease, God, and your spirit within him would increase, God, so that he can communicate your word effectively, God. I pray that you would be preparing even now the hearts and the minds of all of those, of all of us that are here together, God, and that we would leave here having encountered you and we would be different in the, than the way we came, God, that you would move in power, that you would move in might as only you can, God. We love you. We praise you, God, and we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Come on, let's stand together as we worship.
I'm barely hanging on by a thread of hope, hard to see beyond. Everything unknown, with your strength I stand. It's all I can do. I will lift my hands and sing my way through. Yes. So when I'm broken and my weakest in my darkest hour, I'll let my worship be a weapon on this battleground. Now
my song echoes through an empty grave. Yes, 'cause the cross burned.
I stand in awe. You're the God over all. Today in this moment, we declare it, God, because we know it is true, Lord. We know it is true. And everything else that is so untrue around us, that is the truth. And so we thank you, God, that you are just worthy of our praise, Father, that your name is higher than anything else that's going on. Anything else that's going on, God. We love you, Father, and it is in your matchless, mighty name that we all declare together. Amen. Amen. You guys can go ahead and have a seat.
Good morning, church. Good morning. Wow, it is good to worship the Lord, isn't it? I have a question. Does anyone else here have that one like weird room in your house that you're like not quite sure what to do with? Maybe it's a spare bedroom that's kind of turned into a storage room. Or maybe it's another room that when friends and family come over, you close the door and you don't let anyone open that door. You keep it shut, right? Does anyone else have that room in their house? Anyone else here? A couple of us? All right. For me, it's my garage right now. Okay. I know that it's supposed to be a place where we park our cars, but it's not. We park our cars in the driveway, and instead, our garage, well, it's a bit embarrassing. It's kind of like a storage room slash tool shed slash place to keep cardboard boxes, weirdly enough, slash a place to keep things that we don't want to throw away yet, but we don't want to keep them. Are we hoarders? I don't know. And that's what our garage is. And I'll just say this, that it doesn't look nice. When I take the garbage bins out to the road, I try to do that very quickly so that no one can see into my garage, and then I quickly run back and I press the button and close the garage doors. Or I try to do it late at night when no one's awake, and then I'll pull them out. I'm that guy that you hear rolling the garbage bins out at like 12 o'clock at night. That's me. I'm that guy. Because I don't want anyone to see inside the train wreck that is my garage. It's embarrassing. I don't like it. I don't like to look at it. I don't like to talk about it. I don't like to be in there. I don't like people seeing it. It is just this weird room in our home, and I try to avoid it really at all costs. And today, the title of our message is The Ministry of the Holy Spirit Through Me. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're going to be in verse 4 through 13. And I think sometimes we can view the ministry of the Holy Spirit through me like that strange room in our home, especially when we talk about the spiritual gifts. I don't know what to do about that. It makes me kind of uncomfortable. I don't like talking about it. I'm just going to avoid it. I'm just going to close the door here and not let anyone see. I'm just going to walk away from that. So I'm going to repeat what I said last week, if you remember, is that we're not going to do that. We're going to press into the mystery of the Holy Spirit. We are going to press into the tension of the Holy Spirit in hopes that we would have a better and more robust theology of the Holy Spirit. Last week, we looked at the ministry of the Holy Spirit to me, and this week, we're going to be looking at the ministry of the Holy Spirit through me. And I think this needs to be said, the primary mission, not the only, but the primary mission of the Holy Spirit is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so that means that the primary purpose of the ministry of the Holy Spirit in me and through me is to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, that is important, and I want us to remember that as we're walking through the sermon today. But before we jump in, let's pray. God, we come before you, and we are thankful for your word, Lord. I pray right now that you would remove me, that you would speak what you have for our church today. Lord, would we lean into the truths of your word? Lord, we trust you, we love you, and we're thankful for this time that we can be together learning about you from your word. We pray all of this in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. So we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, starting in verse 4. Let's read it together. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the ability to distinguish between spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. So here's the first thing that we're going to see in the text today for us is that you have been given a gift. You have been given a gift. The ministry of the Holy Spirit is primarily, not only, but primarily accomplished through me by the giving of a gift. In verse 4, we see that there is a variety of gifts that the Holy Spirit gives, meaning different gifts, but the same Holy Spirit who gives them. And I want to focus our attention on verse 7 because there are some important truths in here that I want us to grab a hold of. So let's go through verse 7 together a couple of words at a time. What are the first two words? To each. To each. Another way to say this would be to each and everyone. To each and everyone. So this gift that the Holy Spirit gives is to each and everyone who has the Holy Spirit. Everyone who is saved is given a gift by the Holy Spirit. That's the first truth for us, that everyone has a gift. Everyone has a gift. Here's the next phrase. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit. This word manifestation in the Greek is phanerosis, and which means it can be translated manifestation, but it could also be translated as disclosure or evidence of or a demonstration of. So this gift that we are given by the Holy Spirit that each believer has is not something that we have naturally. It's not something that we have worked at. It is not something that we have produced in ourselves. Instead, it is a supernatural gift that is supernaturally given by the Spirit. It is a demonstration of or a manifestation of the Spirit. And then these last four words, for the common good. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. Here's the next truth we see, is that the gift that you have been given isn't for you. The gift that you have been given is for others. Do you see that in the text? It is for the common good. It is for the benefit of others. The gift that we receive from the Holy Spirit is not for us. It is others focused. It's for others. Now, I got no less than 3 emails last week asking me, Pastor Tommy, where were the props? And I just got to say, I'm feeling a bit stereotyped, okay? I'm feeling a bit typecast. I am not the prop guy, okay? So with all that being said, I have a prop, okay? It's unrelated. And this is a gift, and you seem a little lonely over here, so I'm gonna give you this gift. Now, I want you to take this, and you didn't do anything to produce this, right? You didn't even know I was gonna give you this gift, but I'm gonna give you this gift, and there's some good things in here, and I want you to do with it, I hope you're listening to the message. If not, just give me a wink, and I'll tell you what to do. I want you to take that gift, and now I want you to open it, and what do you think that you should do with that gift that I've given you, which is delicious treats? For the benefit of others. Yeah, come on, go for it. Go for it, that's right. Come on. Yes, exactly. Now, this is why you sit in the front row at church, okay? That's why you sit in the front row. So now he is passing out the gift that he has been given because it's not for him. It is for others. It is to the benefit of others. And now people are receiving delicious treats and Snickers bars because you're not you when you're hungry. Not sponsored. Okay? And the gift that the Spirit gives, can I just say this, is way better than simple treats. And I'm sorry that I gave you so many treats. You're going to be passing them out for a while. But it is for the benefit of others. The gift that we have been given supernaturally is not for us. It is for others. So let's say all of that truth in a sentence, okay? You are given a supernatural gift that is a demonstration of the Holy Spirit to be used to benefit others for the glory of Jesus Christ. So what are these gifts? That sounds awesome. What are these gifts? Well, we have a list here in the text, and it isn't an exhaustive list by any means of the spiritual gifts, but listen, I'm gonna put the whole list of spiritual gifts in our message application guide so that you can go through that as a small group together. But here's what we see in this passage, a couple of the spiritual gifts. First, we see the utterance of wisdom. We see the utterance of wisdom. This gift of wisdom is to be able to apply knowledge, the knowledge of God and his word, in such a way as to make spiritual truths very relevant and practical in decision-making and daily life situations. This is the amazing gift of applying knowledge to ours and others' lives. Then we have, of course, the gift of knowledge, the utterance of knowledge. This is the gift of someone who is actively pursuing the knowledge of the Bible, the knowledge of God. They have wide swaths of the scriptures memorized, and at any moment in time, they can bring to memory scriptures to give and to speak over other people. We have the gift of faith. Now, it needs to be said, we all have a measure of faith. Amen, right? We all have a measure of faith, faith in Jesus Christ, but there is a gift of faith that the people who have this gift have such great confidence in the power and promises of God that they can stand strong no matter what situations or circumstances come their way. They are immovable. They have the gift of faith. And then we see this in the scripture. It says the ability to distinguish between spirits. That's the gift of discernment. It's the gift of discernment. It's the gift to recognize whether or not something is truly from God or is in accordance with righteousness, whether that be teaching or even a person. It's a gift of discernment. Now, you might have noticed we have five gifts left. We have five left in this passage, and these gifts are called the sign gifts. They're called the sign gifts, and they are healing, which is the gift to physically, emotionally, mentally, spiritually heal others. There's the gift of miracles, which is the gift to do the supernatural, mighty deeds that only are accomplishable by God. We have the gift of prophecy, which is to speak forth the message of God to his people through divine revelation or through his word. We have the gift of tongues, which is to speak in another language not previously known by a person so that unbelievers can hear God's message in their own language, or it's used for the body to be edified. And then we have the interpretation of tongues, which is the gift to translate the message of someone who has spoken in tongues. Now, we have these five gifts, and here is where a lot of people get stuck. We get stuck. These are mysterious. They're hard to understand. We don't really know what to do with these gifts, and so what do we do with them? Well, naturally, we fight about it, right? We fight about it. We fight. We have two groups of people. I'm gonna give you two words, cessationist and continuationist, okay? Cessationist and continuationist. These are the two groups that fight on this issue. And the cessationist is the group of people who believe that the spiritual gifts, these five gifts have ceased. They believe that these gifts were only for a specific period in time, which was the apostolic era. And after the apostolic era ended, so did these gifts. These gifts were a sign to those that would see Jesus, that they would believe in Jesus, that it would be an authenticating of the ministry of Jesus. That's what these gifts were. And they ceased to be after the apostolic era ended. They are not for the church today. That's what the cessationist believes. Then we have the continuationist, really creative titles, right? They believe that it has continued. These gifts have continued through, that they weren't just for a specific moment in time, but instead, they have continued from the moment we see them in Scripture all the way up to the present day, being the same form of the gift. That's what the continuationist believes. And so we have these two sides, cessationist, continuationist, and they fight. And they fight, and they fight. Maybe some of you are eyeing your neighbor. You're like, I know what you believe on this. And you're like, let's fight. They fight, and they fight, and they fight. And then they divide. And then from further away, they fight again, and they continue fighting. And we get kind of swept up into this, and we start to boil down the power of the Holy Spirit's ministry through us to just these five gifts. Right here, these are the only five gifts that we're going to talk about. And we focus on these five, and we fight about these five, and we divide about these five, and we lose perspective of the whole ministry of the Holy Spirit. When we just focus on these five gifts, we are being incredibly irresponsible with the power of the Holy Spirit. So here's what I'm going to say on this matter. You can be a cessationist and worship at our church. And you can be a continuationist and worship at our church. What you can't be is divisive, because being dividing is the antithetical to the work of the Holy Spirit, which is a unifying spirit, a unifying work. And so we can have discussion on this, and we can disagree. And guess what? We can still be unified together. Amen? Amen. So back to the message. So to the person who is sitting in their seat right now across all of our campuses and online, and you're like, man, that is awesome. I have a gift. That's amazing. How do I know what it is? Well, listen, good news is this isn't some cosmic Easter egg hunt that you have to go through to track down what your gift is. We just have to uncover it, okay? We just have to discover it. And we could do that a couple of ways. The first method that I would give to you as a starting point would be to take a spiritual gift test. And we actually have one of these at our website, on our website, harvestbiblechapel.org/discovermygift. It takes about 15 to 20 minutes, and you can sit down, answer these questions truthfully, okay, about, they're questions about you, so answer them truthfully about who you are, not who you want to be. That's a really important distinction. Take this test, and then it'll give you, I think it's six results of what your top six giftings might be. Now, the big word there is might. This isn't a test that you take and say, these are it, okay? It's not 100%. What you should do then with that spiritual gift test is you should take those results and you should take them to someone who is close to you, someone who knows you, someone who speaks truth to you, and ask them, hey, are any of these true of me? Do you see these giftings in my life? Do you see this apparent in me? Not just a little bit, but really overflowing. Do you see these gifts in me? And they might narrow it down. Maybe they'll pick two or three or maybe even more. And then what you need to do is you need to serve in that area of gifting. You need to serve in that area of gifting. Find a place to serve that lines up with those gifts and serve. Because through the using of our gifts, through the serving in that gifting, we are going to see one, incredible things happen. We're going to see the Holy Spirit move in power in our life. And not only that, but we are going to feel an incredible joy that is truly, and I say this truly, unexplainable. A joy overflowing as you live out the gift that the Holy Spirit has given you. And so, you need to know that truth. You have been given a gift. Here's the next thing. We find it in verse 11. Let's read this together. Chapter 12, verse 11. All these, speaking of the gifts, are empowered by one and the same Spirit who appoints to each one individually as he wills. Here's the second thing we're going to see this morning. That is, you are empowered to use your gift. You are empowered to use your gift. This is not self-produced in you. This is supernaturally given, and you are also empowered by the Holy Spirit. It is not of our power that these gifts operate, but it is by the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank God, right? Thank God. I am so glad that it doesn't depend on me, but that it depends on the power of God in me because I am weak. Amen? Even coming up here and preaching, I'm weak. You need to know that. Every time I come up to preach, I am trembling. I am afraid. I am anxious. In the back of my mind, I go to thoughts like someone better should be up here instead of me. I am not good enough to be preaching to our whole church. I am not smart enough to be dissecting God's word and sharing it with our church. Someone better should be doing this, not me. But God. The Holy Spirit empowers me in my weakness, and those fears and those attacks fade as I operate in the power of the Holy Spirit in a gift that He has given me. And if what I just described was you as well, maybe not in the area of preaching, but in anywhere that the Holy Spirit has gifted you and your mind goes to, I'm not going to do it. There's someone better out there that is right for this, that they should do this, not me, they're better. Don't be paralyzed by that, church. Don't be paralyzed by that. God wants to use you. God wants to use the gift that He has given to you. He doesn't want to use someone else's. He wants to use yours. And so step out in faith and know that there is no one better than the Holy Spirit. No one. And it is He who empowers you, not yourself. So live in the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Maybe you're on the other side of that. I've been there too. It's not the fear that paralyzes you, it's the self-sufficiency that makes you ineffective. You rely on yourself. I could do this. I could do this in my own power. I'm smart enough. I've practiced enough. I've used this gift enough. I can do this by myself. And maybe what you're seeing is that you aren't really having an impact with your gift. You're ineffective. And maybe you try to double down and try harder and try harder and try harder and nothing seems to be working. You're not relying on the empowering of the Holy Spirit. I think about it like we have a mountain of work in front of us, okay? It's a mountain, it's a lot, right? And in front of us, right in front of us, we have a shovel and we have dynamite. And what do? Well, I pick up the shovel, here we go. Okay, I'm gonna tear this mountain down, and we start digging into the side of this giant mountain and we're like, I'm gonna make some progress. I'm gonna dig a hole straight through this mountain. It's gonna be great. And then what happens? We get tired. My arms start getting heavy. The shovelfuls become less. And then I stop and I need to take a break because I'm exhausted. And when I look back at the mountain of work, what do I see? I see but a divot. And this, I know, right? And we do this to ourselves, don't we? I see a divot. And we use a shovel. But what we have available for us is dynamite. And when we put that next to the mountain of work that needs to be done and fan the flame alive, we see something go off in power. Explosive power, taking wide chunks out of this mountain. Not in our power, but in the power of the dynamite. And that is like the Holy Spirit empowering us. The self-sufficiency is me picking up the shovel, trying to do it myself. But we have available to us the empowering of the Holy Spirit, which is like dynamite. It is powerful. It is powerful. We choose the shovel far too often. So let's live in the empowering of the Holy Spirit, not for our glory, but for the Lord's. So we see that He empowers our gift. But not only that, it says that He apportions individually as He wills. It's the later part of the verse 11. He apportions individually as he wills. This is the Spirit sovereignly giving these gifts. It's as he wills. These gifts we receive are according to his will. Again, solidifying that it does not come from us. It doesn't come from us, but they come from the Holy Spirit. And also, you have been given the exact gift that the Holy Spirit wanted you to have. Now, this can mess us up a little bit. It can. We can start to think, well, God, why didn't you give me this gift instead? I don't want the gift of administration. I want the gift of wisdom. I don't want the gift of mercy. I want the gift of hospitality. I don't want the gift of faith. I want the gift of preaching. And so on and so on and so on. And we can become dissatisfied or discontent with the gift that we have been given. And so maybe that's you. Maybe you're here today and you are feeling discontent with the gift that you have received. Can I give you just three things? Three things. First is you can pray for gifts. We've seen a couple of chapters, Paul encouraged this. You can pray for another gift. Now, that doesn't mean that you are going to receive that gift. Again, it is as the Holy Spirit wills. It is his sovereign choice, not yours. And so he may choose to give you the gift that you pray for, but he may not. And so what happens when you pray for a gift and don't receive? Well, you can continue to pray, but you can also pray something else. You can pray that your gift that you have been given would be used in greater ways. Lord, would you, not selfishly as a look at me, but Lord, would you use this gift that you have given me in ways that I never thought imaginable? Maybe I, Lord, have just a small view of what this gift is, and Lord, would you use it in a way that I haven't even thought of, in a greater way than I have ever thought of? You could pray for that. You can also pray to be content with the gift that you have. Lord, I do desire a different gift, another gift, but Lord, would you grant me contentment? Would you give me contentment in this gift? Because you have chosen it for me. This wonderful gift, you have given it to me. And would I be content in only that, that it's from you? So you have a gift. You're empowered to use your gift. And then finally this, verse 12 and 13. Let's read it together. Just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one Spirit. That is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit right there at the end. The drinking of one Spirit is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Here's the third and final thing. You are brought together in unity with your gift. You are brought together in unity with your gift. Although we have different gifts, we are brought together in unity into the body of Christ. No singular person or singular gift is the body of Christ on its own. The body is made up of many members with different gifts, with different people. And we see this reflection of unity not only here, but in verse 4, 5, and 6. Did you catch it while we were reading through it? Did you notice it? We see this reflection of the Trinity. In verse 4, we see the Holy Spirit. In verse 5, we see the Lord, who is Jesus Christ. In verse 6, we see God the Father, the Trinity, the Godhead, working together in unity in the life of a believer. And we are to example that working together in unity with our gift as the body of Christ. Your gift is essential for the body of Christ. It is essential for our body, specifically speaking, our body here, our church, Harvest Bible Chapel. Your gift is essential for our body to be whole, for our body to be performing at peak performance. It is essential. Your gift is not a small thing. No one's gift is a small thing. Your gift is also not a big thing. No one's gift is a big thing. They are equally important when it comes to functioning together as a body. Because listen, we can do so much more together than we could ever do alone. As a body of Christ, we could do so much more together than we could ever do apart. It is why Jesus said in John 14:12, "Whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father." The greater works there are not greater miracles. We're not one-upping Jesus, okay? The greater works are they're greater in quantity, okay? Because we now have God dwelling in every single believer and this body of Christ, not just in the Middle East, but everywhere around the world, in unity together with our gift to do greater ministry together. And so we're brought together in this unity. The verse says, "For in one spirit we are all baptized into one body." And I want to unpack this, because I think that this phrase, baptism of the Holy Spirit, has many people confused. And it really comes down to this. It comes down to a question. Yeah, we're going there, all right? Here we go. It comes down to a question. What do you mean by baptism of the Holy Spirit? It's a great question to ask. What do you mean by baptism of the Holy Spirit? I think that we would save ourselves a lot of arguing if we started with this question, because I think sometimes it's less of a doctrinal thing, and I think it's more of a vocabulary thing. Now, for instance, if they say something like, "The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a separate moment from salvation in which you receive the Holy Spirit and all that accompanies the Holy Spirit," or if they say something like, "You receive the Holy Spirit at salvation, and then the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a second experience in which you gain new access or more of the Holy Spirit," then yeah, that's a doctrinal issue. But for instance, if they say something like this, if they say you receive the Holy Spirit at salvation and all that he brings, but the baptism of the Holy Spirit is when you are filled to the brim with the Holy Spirit overflowing in joy and empowered to go and do the work of the Holy Spirit. Well, there, we have less of a doctrinal issue and more of a vocabulary issue. You see, we believe that that first receiving of the Holy Spirit at salvation, that is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. As plainly laid out by Paul here in verse 13, look at the text, verse 13, "For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body." The important words were important words. We were all. We were, pointing back to the moment of salvation, and all, meaning all believers, okay? Meaning all believers, not just a select spiritual few, all believers. We were all baptized into the Spirit. But then what they would call maybe baptism of the Spirit in that moment, we would use a word that we see consistently throughout Scripture, which is filling. The filling of the Holy Spirit. And so while, yes, there are some doctrinal issues, there are some vocabulary pieces as well. And so what we say here at our church is we say one baptism that happens at salvation, we receive all of the Holy Spirit. It is a once and for all, non-repeated event. One baptism, many fillings. One baptism, many fillings. We receive all of the Holy Spirit at salvation. God is not giving us installments of the Holy Spirit, okay? We get all of the Holy Spirit at salvation. And then through our new lives in Christ with the Holy Spirit, we are going to sin. We will. And we will drift away from God. We will. We will make mistakes. We will. We will err. That is going to happen in our life, and we need fresh fillings of the Holy Spirit. To be filled with the Spirit is freedom for him to occupy every part of our lives, guiding and controlling us. And sin hinders that filling, while obedience maintains it. And so we, as a church, we should desire this filling of the Holy Spirit afresh, to be controlled by the Holy Spirit completely, to have him produce in me the fruits of his Spirit, which are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, and to more effectively minister through me by the empowering of the gift that he has given me. So how do I get that filling? How do I get that filling of the Holy Spirit? I desire that. Do you desire that? I desire that. Well, it's not something you can get. Sorry, I kind of led you on there. It's not something that you can get. It's something that the Spirit gives. It's something that the Spirit gives. So, come before God. Confess your sin, which would hinder his filling in your life, and ask for a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit in your life. Amen? So the Holy Spirit ministers through me by the giving of this gift, by the empowering of this gift, by bringing us into unity together with these gifts. And I want to end our time in this message and in this series with an illustration that our friend, Pastor Andy Rozier, gave me this week as we were talking about it. And we had a great discussion about it, and we were talking about this. Let's start with the question. Why is it called a gift? Why is it called a gift? It could have used many different words, right? For something we receive, could have used a different word. But he calls it a gift. And I think that that's very significant. And here's why. Let's think about another thing that we receive, which is something like an award, right? We receive an award. And I want you to think about this. Let's take the great award ceremonies, right? The Grammys, the Oscars. And when someone goes up and receives an award, what is your mind brought to in that moment? The thing our mind is brought to in that moment is, wow, what a great accomplishment. Wow, look at what that person did. Wow, look at how great that person is. An award points to the recipient. When you think about an award, you think about the one receiving the award. An award is about the recipient. But when you think about a gift, where is your mind brought to? To the giver. When you think of a gift, your mind is brought to the giver. A gift is about the giver. There's a reason that it's called a gift and not an award. I want you to think about the most amazing gift that you have ever received. I'm wearing mine. This is the greatest gift that I've ever received. And when I look at it, I think of the giver. I think of my wife. I don't think about myself. I don't think about who manufactured the ring. I think about my precious wife who gave me this gift. And we need to treat the gift of the Holy Spirit like a gift, not an award. Remember, the primary purpose, mission of the Holy Spirit is what? To glorify Jesus Christ. This gift is not for my glory. It's not to make me say, look how good I am, look how great I am. The Holy Spirit ministering to me and through me is for the glory of Jesus Christ alone. And when we think about the gift, our mind should be brought to the giver. We should praise the Lord and glorify the name of Jesus Christ for the amazing work that he is doing in us and through us. The Holy Spirit has empowered you with a gift. He has empowered us all with a gift. And he fills us to go out with that gift to benefit others for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the ministry of the Holy Spirit through us.
And so, church, let us not leave today devoid of the power of the Holy Spirit, but instead let us feel the empowering of the Holy Spirit, asking for a fresh filling of the Spirit and allowing him to minister through us so we can impact our church and our communities for the glory of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's pray. God, we come before you, and Lord, we are thankful. Thankful for a time in your word. Thankful for the wonderful gift that you have given us. And Lord, when we think about that, we are reminded of you. And so, Lord, we pray right now, would you empower this gift? Would we live in that empowering of the gift? Would we not do it on our own strength? Lord, would we not be paralyzed in fear, but would we live in the power of the Holy Spirit? Lord, we praise you for bringing us together as a body. Thank you, Lord, that we're not doing this alone, that we have each other. And because we are different people and with different giftings that you have sovereignly given, we can do great ministry. You can do great ministry through us. And so, Lord, we surrender. Would you fill us afresh? Fill us, Lord. We love you. We thank you. We praise all of this. Pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Up and send us out in the fullness of your power for your kingdom and your crown. Will you go with us as we hear your Spirit call? Take us out beyond these walls where we will
Thank you, Pastor Tommy, for opening up God's word with us today. The Holy Spirit truly is so powerful, and what a gift from the Lord. Three quick things before you go. We hope that you will join us this Thursday, March 11th at 7:30 p.m. for our worship night at the Rolling Meadows campus. We also encourage you to get more details for Easter, Good Friday, the Seder dinner, and the Harvest Kids Easter birthday party at harvestnow.info. We also want to invite you to come back next Sunday at 9 a.m. or 11 a.m. Central Standard Time as we begin our new teaching series with Dr. Rydelnik out of the Book of Ephesians. And if you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, we would love to see you in person at any of our campuses. And don't forget that you are loved.